Welcome back to my channel, and this is part two with my interviews with Adib. So he is a pricing PNC actuary, and in today's episode, he will share with us more detail about his pricing work. So as an actuary, the two traditional areas are pricing and valuation. So I think it's very important for you to know a little more about the pricing work. And this episode, we will talk more about the pricing of work from in general insurance areas. And in the future, I will have someone to talk about the pricing work in life insurance companies. Adil, what are the responsibilities of a P&C actuary in the pricing area?
That's what I say, like a manifold question, but I'll try to answer it in as precisely as possible. So responsibilities for pricing actuary, I would say, first of all, it requires kind of modifying or updating the prices of the existing products, first of all. And that I will go in 1 second. And the other side is also kind of understanding how you price a new product. So those are the two branches, I would say. Going back to the first branch of updating the pricing, or the product already exists and you have a pricing in the past, how do you update that? Is as a PNC actuary, most of the companies have switched on to either R or either Python to do their models. So there would be a normal day in a PNC actuary life. You would be either doing modeling of the loss data of whichever product. The one I have worked on is auto and property. So you would run, in the past, we have worked on GLM, so generalized linear models. But over the past couple of years, the industry is kind of switching to machine learning models. And that's why a lot of PNC companies are hiring data scientists right now to work together with actuaries to kind of get some value out of that. And also, on the other hand, using these technical languages, Python or SAS or some Excel for that sake, is to even understand the profitability on the already existing product. So as a pricing actuary, your job is also to evaluate different segments of the market, which ones are profitable, as I precisely mentioned, and which ones are not, and how do you want to exit out of the market? You have to make those decisions. Can you increase the prices? Can you somehow have another loss-cutting initiative? Maybe it could be training the individuals in that area for a certain thing. So those are the kind of factors you look for. First of all, pricing it. And then secondly, other than price, what other actions you could take, let's say call it like a non-price actions to increase the profitability or get the profitability where it's supposed to be, or shed the risk which you don't want to write. On the other hand, on the other path, which I said, like pricing the new product, that's where I think the most interesting, more challenging work is, because you don't have any data most of the time. You're creating a product, and you're working a lot with underwriters, working a lot with the marketing team per se to understand. And a lot of it is you're working in the uncharted territory. So you have to make a lot of assumptions. And I think that's where you would agree with me that it's what we're good at, making assumptions about everything. So so a lot of fun work there, working with data scientists extensively. And at the end of the day, making a lot of business decisions that does it make sense? I'll give you an example. Like in a car insurance, does it make sense to include the color of the car as being a predictive variable in the prices? Well, intuitively, it does not make sense. Like the color of the car should not determine what the losses should be on that vehicle. But if this data is significant, should be included, what would regulators think? Would it pass through by the consumers? Like how, so those type of questions are what we deal with it on a daily basis as a PNC pricing actuary. Reserving is another story, and which probably I won't be able to touch on because of the fact that I don't have that particular experience.
For life insurance company, it's very similar about the two branches of the pricing work. So it's like if you already have a product, so how would you update the assumptions or the pricings for those products? And then the more challenging, but something like I would say more fun is for new product development. So now let's talk about the top skill set that a pricing actually should have, especially in the general insurance.
Being in any actuary, first of all, the general skill set would be having the technical skills, if I say, of understanding. When I say technical skills, I don't mean coding in Python or that could be learned or sometimes kind of subordinated to someone else. But what I say is technical skills is understanding your bread and butter of pricing, what I call it. So understanding what factors imply changes in pricing. And we're using the loss data from the past. How do you take that past loss data and use it to project future losses? Aren't the loss going to change based on different external factors? Like How are you going to account for those? So these kind of things, which I call the bread and butter, which I think a PNC actuary or a general insurance actuary learns in one of the very amazing and basic exam, exam five, what they call it, the basic rate making and reserving on the casualty actuarial society side. So that one, I think, is what I would say. If someone wants to learn, someone wants to understand how PNC actuaries price, that's the exam, or and the, even the syllabus and the course material of the exam is free of charge, available online. So if you want to check it out, like, I think that's the best way to look at like how we price. So understanding that part is first thing. And I would say other thing is willing to ask questions. And when I say willing to ask questions, a lot of our work as PNC actuaries is asking the question as much as we can to either underwriters, like, because they are closer to the market, whether it makes sense, what is working, what is not working, marketing team, like which area should be market, which area should be not, what are the other factors, a lot of communication to the stakeholders of the project. So I would say a lot of it involves asking the right questions and being curious to understand, curious to learn, and willing to adapt and change. Because I think one thing general insurance teaches us is how, based on different impacts happening in the world due to different events, how the product needs to be changed. As you would see on the general insurance side, due to COVID-19 for the past year, cyber insurance has skyrocketed. Like that has picked up a lot of traction over the past year, just because everybody has gone online. Car insurance on the other side is picking up a lot of traction on the autonomous vehicle side. Property insurance is picking up another tangent in which you can buy insurance per day or wherever you like. It's pay as you go kind of insurance. So I think it is good, and you will be successful if you are willing to adapt and willing to learn more, I would say.
I totally agree about the questioning everything and the curiosity, because that is how we can see and learn new things and thinking outside the box as well. Like by talking to different people, asking different questions, then you may be able to think new different ideas. And that is very helpful, especially when you actually work on a new product development. What is the must-have knowledge that one must know when doing pricing?
Sure, and I would kind of shed some light on some of the basics of the pricing. I think the basics is, I would say, think about it as a layman, that you are working off with the past losses. Let's say take an automobile, for example. So you're working on automobile losses, auto losses for a certain province. You have this loss data for past, let's say, 10 years, because it's enough to kind of make your models credible. And now you want to take that past your 10 years worth of data and project it into the future, like for the next year or next 2 years. How do you do that? I think that's where I call the bread and butter of pricing. And when I call the bread and butter, I don't mean just auto pricing. When I talk about these concepts, it's relevant in any pricing. So what I mean by that is, first of all, when you look at any data, you ask yourself, what changed from when this happened to the future? Because you want these losses, the past losses, to be reflective of the future, right? So when you're projecting for year 2021, the losses, and you have this year 2011 in your loss data, how do you take these losses in 2011 and say they're comparable to these losses in the future? How do you do that? There are multiple things that you have to be aware of. First of all, there are a lot of trends. Like let's say in 2011, the losses, the auto losses, were limited by a mandated limit by the government of $500,000. So anybody cannot claim more than $500,000. But in prospective year 2021, now the limit is 1 million. But we never know how those losses would have developed if their limit would have been 1 million, right? So a lot of subjective assumptions are made, what we call the increased limit factors, and a lot of projections are made to take this amount in 2011 and project it to 2021 based on these changes. So this is what we call the trend factors. There's other thing we call the on-level factors. On-level factors are, okay, in 2011, you had these losses and you charged this much premium. But in today's money, those losses and those premiums are very different, because those are $2011. Those are not $2021. So you have these on-level factors, which take these losses and premiums and bring them to the 2021 level based on whatever changes happen. So changes could include, on the premium side, a lot of premium rate changes you took. So from 2011 to 2021, you took 20% increase in the premium. So if you were to write the same risk, which you wrote in 2011, now you would be getting 20% more premium for that. So that's what we call premium on leveling. There's also losses on leveling. So in 2011, one of the examples I gave was that limit one we just started off with. There could be other factors that government introduced a new, let's say, they're saying that now this particular part is not included in the losses. Let's say government says that automobile losses will not cover you driving other vehicle, for example. So now 2011 losses did cover those. but 2021 would not cover those. So how do we remove them from 2011 to 2021? So those adjustments on an aggregate basis is what we call the on-level adjustments. And last of all, well, one of the last things you work on is with other assumptions like expenses, like what you want the profit and your return on equity on. And once you have this data which you have projected into the future, so how this data would look like in the future policy period, then you run a model on it and figure out the predictive variables. And then once you have a model, then you add on top of that, you add in a layer of expenses, profitability, and get your final price. And again, I just simplified it in a couple of minutes. There's a lot that goes behind it, but of course, on a very high level of scheme, that's how you price it. And when I said, at the start of our conversation, that it's bread and butter, what I mean is that it's not really applicable to auto insurance. You can take any other product you want to price. Let's say you want to price, and I'm just taking an example, you want to price a product in a restaurant, right? Which is just as a burrito, right? So you want to price a burrito, right? How do you price it? And I call it this actuarial price, is you take the past data, you do the same thing. The burritos costed $6, let's say, in 2009. There has been on-level factors you're going to apply. There's going to be trend you're going to apply. Then you're going to run a model, and then you're going to add your assumption. So this bread and butter of pricing could be applied to any product, not just auto insurance or not just property insurance. It's just a basic model which could be taken and adapted to any pricing, I would say.
In the life insurance side, I know that we normally use GTYSs in order to do pricing work, and then sometimes like Excel as well. How about in general insurance, like from your experience, what are the different applications or software that you guys use?
I would say in terms of the software is required, or I should probably rephrase it, in softwares we use, I wouldn't say required, because when I even started, I did not know any of the softwares. I just learned over time. So softwares we use, when I started off in 2015, we used to use, for GLM, we used to use Emblem from Towers Watson. And it was a licensed software, which I wouldn't imagine someone can buy as a student or as someone who wants to learn. It's not an open source. So, but I think over time, industry has moved from that. Some companies still use that. But however, most companies have moved to what we call R, which I think most of the universities use, and Python. So whichever one, some companies are in the phase of transitioning to Python, some are already in R. So I would say, if you ask me which languages or which technical skills you need to have, I think I would say Python is the industry changer. And I think that's where the industry is headed. So if you want to pick on one language, if you want it would be Python on the PNC side or the general insurance side, I would say. A lot of work is still in Excel for some of the things in which we don't require models. Like let's say when I talk about commercial insurance space, a lot of times because we are working on one-off accounts, we don't need a model for that, so we work on Excel spreadsheets. So it depends on the type of the work, but most of it can be done in Python, and I think that's one thing if you want to invest in. But as I said, like a lot of times you don't need to like completely be a Python guru, I would call it, but just having a basic understanding of what a tool can do for you would help you solve the problems faster.
Also started picking up some R and Python coding in the past few years, although we have not used much for our work, but it is very powerful, especially to help with modeling, stochastic and so on. And so now can you tell us a little bit more about the common methods that you use for your pricing work? How about the assumptions? Like what are the assumptions that typically you need to deal with when for pricing a P&C product?
So in terms of common methods for pricing, first of all, like as I said, in one of the past questions is you start off with the base data, and in terms of applications you use to price a product, I would say there are multiple ways you can use to price it. I want to tell much information, but not go into too much detail. A lot of times one way to price it is we create what we call a chain ladder approach. And what that is, chain ladder approach, is we create loss triangles. And that's one thing, if you're really interested in knowing, I would suggest looking at exam 5 syllabus and the course outline there. But we create how losses develop. So by each year, let's say, let me call it this way. So by each year, losses at 12 month period, what they look like, and the same cohort of losses, how it looks like in 24 months, same cohort, how it looks like in 36, 48, 60. So we see how the same bucket of losses develops over time. And we do that for multiple years, so 2012, 2013, 2014. So that's why, as you can see, we'll create a triangle in which the last year would only be developed 12 months, because let's say 2020 losses will only be developed 12 months. 2019 would be developed 24 months. So we would have two numbers. And as you can see, as you go up, you will create like a triangle of losses, which we call it. We use that triangle to figure out the general pattern of how the losses are going to develop over time. If I get a loss of $1,000 next year, what that loss of $1,000 would look like 5 years from then, because losses tend to develop, as you would know. Losses develop over time. A lot of PNC products are long tail products. So you don't even know in the first year or 2 years what the losses are going to be at the end of the 10 years. Some of the losses may even reopen. Sometimes losses are closed. And then, you know, there's another lawsuit being brought up against our client. And boom, there's another claim, which was already closed 5 years back, and now it's reopened. So a lot of times these development happens over time. So I think one approach I would say called pricing is what we call a chain ladder approach, in which we use this approach to take the losses and project it into the future. So one of the other things, which I mentioned slightly, touched on it earlier, like how we project the losses to the future, is this is one of the approach we use, chain ladder. There are multiple other approaches without going in much more detail, like this is one of the majorly used approach, I would say. And in terms of other parts, in terms of the assumptions for pricing, there are quite a bit. So first of all, you're assuming a lot of these factors which you apply. There are a lot of subjectivity involved there. So as an actuary, you could say, you took a look at the past data and you're like, so I could choose a 20% increase year over year on losses. If I use a weighted average, that's 25%. If I exclude this year, it's 23%. So you have a bunch of averages, and you can choose whichever one you want as long as you can justify it. So I think that's where one of the assumptions is that choosing these factors, let it be these development factors, let it be the on-level factors, if you talked about in one of the last responses I gave, let it be the trend factors, how the losses are trending, let it be inflation, let it be the interest rate on to get your return on equity. There are a lot of assumptions on the expenses side, because expenses is a tricky thing too. You have commissions. And a lot of these, and I'm not saying that actuaries throw out numbers from the air. Like, they do their analyses, let's say for commissions, they have their data coming from the finance. For the expenses, let's say underwriting, marketing, those are coming from the finance. So you make those educated guesstimates, what I call it, which is like, you're not guessing completely, but you are guessing smartly, I would say. And I think that's where a lot of assumptions are feeded into, is that the selection of the factors, which are actually subjective, but not so subjective at the same time.
So yeah, for life insurance products, I think the top insurance risk for us will be mortality or longevity or mobility, depending on the products. And then yes, we also have like lapses, expenses, and then the credit and market risk assumptions. So we have been talking a lot about the skill set and different applications and knowledge that one need to have for pricing actuary. And given that like today, technology has developed and advanced so rapidly, and environment has changed very quickly, what are the different skill set and knowledge do you think an actuary need to equip in order to be, in a way, future proof?
I would say, first of all, in this changing environment, especially on the general insurance side of the PNC side, is adaptability and adapting to what? So adapting to change it, I would say, is that first of all, these basic pricing techniques, which I call the bread and butter, and I refer to them as bread and butter in my whole conversation, is for a reason, because it doesn't matter how much the product changed, these techniques are there to stay. So how you look at looking at the past data and how you project it in the future, that techniques or that understanding is going to stay the same. What is going to change is the product itself. What is going to change is the coverage. And when I say product coverage, I mean, let's think about autonomous vehicles. Maybe not now, maybe 5 years, maybe 10 years, maybe 15 years from now, we're definitely going to have autonomous vehicles. It's just a matter of time. So are the techniques going to change? I don't think so. Or maybe they do, but I don't think so personally. But what is going to change is the product. The product is going to change. The coverage is going to change. Like, what are you covered for? Because the accidents are not going to happen that much, that often. If they happen, who will be responsible for it? Because a person is not driving the vehicle, the machine is. What type of accidents are going to happen? And these all things are going to change. But at the end of the day, when we get the data, whether it's the autonomous vehicles or non-autonomous vehicles, the data is kind of going to look the same. And we might have more variables, if any. But nonetheless, the idea is going to stay the same, how you take the past losses, project it into the future, and then do the modeling on it. Maybe a little more complicated model, but nonetheless, the basic techniques are going to stay the same. So what my advice would be in terms of learning for the technicalities is understand the basics first, completely, not basics by a product. So a lot of people, when they understand the basics, they understand, they take a product, for example, and then they just understand how those techniques are applied to the product. How I like them to learn, or how I would like anyone else to learn, this would be taking a deeper dive or a step back, I would say, for a second, and see how this process could be applied to any product, not just auto product, not just property product, and understand those basics or bread and butter really well. And once you understand that, then you're trained for any type of changes that are going to happen. Secondly, these changes, be aware of it. So definitely, if you're good with the approaches, the pricing techniques and stuff, that's one part. But also be aware of it. Let's say if the industry is changing towards autonomous vehicles, maybe understand what type of risk, what type of coverages, what type of questions there could be when actually that happens. Let's say cyber insurance. So why they are going up? What's going to happen? What type of more coverage can be added on? What more impact you could have using the same techniques? Similarly for any other type of insurance. So industry is going to change, but the basic methodologies are going to stay the same. So master the basic principles. And secondly, be adapt to the product and the coverages changes that come on the way.
I love that. Your first tip is about mastering the basics, because like if we have the foundations, it really helps us to have a strong, solid knowledge about our work. And from there, it's easier to pick up new techniques or advices and or application and so on to help with our work. So that is it, another episode of Get to Know an Actuary and Our Work. And this one is a little bit more technical than usual, but I do think this is helpful for you to really understand about what we do. So are there any areas in the actuarial professions that you would like to hear more about? Feel free to let me know, and I will see you in the next episode. Wishing you another happy productive week, and see you later. Bye.